good morning. I hope all are happy and safe. In our last class, we discussed the differences between autobiography and memoir. Then we started the second chapter, Pilgrim at Tinker Creek, written by Annie Dillard. Annie Dillard is a popular American writer, poet, novelist, naturalist, essayist, critic, theologist, and singer. Her autobiography is An American Childhood. Pilgrim at Tinker Creek is her memoir. This book won the Pulitzer Prize for non-general fiction. Pilgrim at Tinker Creek is an exciting meditation on nature and its seasons. It is personal narrative of writer's exploration during a whole year on foot in her neighborhood in Tinker Creek in Virginia. Let us speak about the textbook. While Annie Dillard was walking along the edges of an island, she noticed a small green frog. It was exactly half in and half out of the water. Maybe that's why she felt it looked like a schematic diagram of an amphibian. But it is schematic diagram means simple diagram. Okay, so when Annie Dillard looked at this small green frog, she felt it is a schematic diagram of an amphibian, but it didn't jump. So she started to observe it in the Tinker Creek, just 4 feet away. It was very small green frog with wild, dull eyes. But the frog slowly crumbled. Crumbled means squeezed. Okay, we are squeezing the lemon for juice. So like that, the frog slowly crumbled and began to sag. Sag means sink. Okay, so when Annie Dillard saw this small green frog, it started to crumble and it began to sag. Its spirit vanished from its eyes. Vanished means disappeared. Actually, at that moment, its eyes were dull. Why? Its spirit vanished from its eyes. Its skin emptied and drooped down. Drooped down means sink down. So its spirit already vanished, its skin emptied, that's why it started to sink down. Its skull collapsed and settled like kicked tent. Then you know, its skull became broken. Then what happened when the skull broke? It already lost its shape. So it just looked like a kicker tent. Here we can see that Annie Dillard used so many comparison with this small green frog. When she first saw this small green frog, she says it just looked like a schematic diagram. When its skull broke, she says it settled like a kicked tent. It was shrinking like a deflating football. Again, she compares this frog to a deflating football. Deflating means let the air out. I think you are very familiar with the balloon which lose its air. So she says when it is shrinked means become smaller in size. When it starts to shrink, it is looked like a deflating football. Its skin became formless as pricked balloon. Then it started to float like bright scum on the top of the water. some. Some means layer of froth on the surface of a liquid. That means it already lost its shape. Its skull already broken. Then its skin emptied. It started to sink. So we can see that it was very monstrous, terrifying thing. The narrator became bewildered. That means confused. Then the frog's skin bag started to sink. So the author already compared this green frog as a schematic diagram. When its skull broke, she compared it with a kicked tent. Then she also compared it with a pricked balloon. Okay. After the tragic end of a green frog, Annie Dillard started to speak about giant water bug. It's an enormous, heavy-bodied brown bug. Giant water bug, it is very big in size. It is brown in color. It eats insects, tadpoles, fish, and frogs. It seizes a victim using its forelegs. I told you, it has a very powerful forelegs. Using those forelegs, it started to hold the victim very tightly. It hugs it tight and paralyzes it with the enzymes injected during the vicious bite. Vicious means very cruel. Then at first it started to hug the victim very tightly. After that, using the vicious bite, it started to inject the victim into the body of the victim. Through the one bite, the poison that dissolves in the victim's muscles and bones and organs. This enzyme is very powerful. It has the power to dissolve the muscles, bones and organs. Then the giant water bug sucks out. Sucks out means pull out. Then after injecting the enzyme into the victim's body, the giant water bug started to suck out and reduced to a juice. How we are sipping the juice? Like that, by using this enzyme, it started to drink the frog as a juice. This event is very common in freshwater. The narrator understood the frog being sucked by the giant water bug. I think all of you understood how giant water bug killed a small green frog. Giant water bug, it is very enormous, brown in color. It has very powerful forelegs. Using the forelegs, it started to hug the victim. After that, it injected the enzyme into the body of green frog. When the enzymes paralyzed the green frog, it started to sip the frog just like a juice. Then she is speaking about the different method of catching prey. Then she is speaking about carnivorous animals, how they are catching prey. I think all of you know about what it is, carnivorous animals. Carnivorous animals eat the meat of other animals and plants. So in the case of carnivorous animals, they devour the prey alive. Devour. Devour means eat hungrily. That is the style of carnivorous animals. Carnivorous animals eat hungrily their prey alive. The narrator explains it in detail. The carnivorous animals grasp the victim. Then, so the victim can't move. Then they start to eat it whole or in a series of bloody bites. It's not just like the giant water bug. In the case of giant water bug, it just used only one bite. Using the one bite, it injected the enzyme into the body of the victim. But in the case of carnivorous animals, using the bloody a series of bloody bites, it started to eat the victim whole. Okay, so I think all of you understood about how carnivorous animals, they are attacking the prey alive. At first, it holds the victim very tightly. At the moment, the victim can't escape from carnivorous animals. After that, it started to eat the victim whole or in a series of bloody bites. Then she is talking about the attacking style of frogs. Have you ever seen how frogs are catching the prey? Frogs eat everything whole. They stuff the prey into their mouth using their thumbs. Frogs have wide jaws. They start to stuff the dragonflies in their mouth and they can't close their mouth. That is the style of frogs. In the case of frogs, they started to attack, they started to eat the victim's whole. Then it started to stuff the victim into their mouth because it has very wide jaws. And even we can see that it is very difficult for them to close their mouth when they are eating dragonflies. Okay, this is the style of frogs they are using to attack the attack their prey. Then she also talks about ants. I think all of you are very familiar with the ants. We already noticed the procession of ants to collect the food materials. It is a very familiar scene for us. Okay, so she talks about ants. Ants do not catch their prey. They swam over newly hatched featherless birds in the nest. Swam over means a large number of things grouped together. Swam over means a large number of things grouped together. We already spoke about the nature of ants. They are always walking just like a procession while they are collecting the food. So like that, they are swarming over newly hatched featherless birds in the nest. Actually, it is happening especially in spring season. They eat them tiny bite by bite. It is not possible for ants to eat the victims whole. So by taking the tiny bite by bite, they started to eat the featherless, newly hatched featherless birds. Okay, so in this paragraph, Annie Dillard talked about the different methods of animals, how they are attacking prey. We talked about carnivorous animals. I told you they are attacking the prey alive by using a series of bloody bites. Then we talked about frogs. Frogs also, they are stuffing the prey whole into their mouths by using the thumbs. It is very difficult for them to close their mouth while they are taking dragon flies. Then we talked about ants. In the case of ants, they are swarming over the newly hatched bird featherless birds. And they eat them tiny bite by bite. Okay. Then through this, Annie Dillard gives a clear picture about small green frog, giant water bug, and how the giant water bug killed the green frog, and the different methods of catching prey. Especially, she talked about the animals, the carnivorous animals, frogs and ants. Then she starts to speak about God and Mysteries of Nature. She says, nature is rough and chancy. Chancy means uncertainty. It is very difficult to find out the mysteries in nature. There are so many mysteries in this nature. We don't know the mysteries of nature. Every living is a survivor because it fights to get a bivouac. Bivouac means temporary shelter. Every living thing, sir, they are very good survivors. They try to find out a shelter, temporary shelter in this nature. They are very confident they can face the challenges because they believe that they are also the they were also made by God. So they believe that they can face all the problems which they are facing. Even we know the reality, it is not possible to survive throughout the entire life. But humans are ready to believe it. I told you, they are trying to survive it because human beings believe they are created by God. Then Annie Dillard speaks about Quran. In Quran, Allah asks a question. The meaning of that question is, the heaven and earth and all in between thinkest thou. Thinkest means think. Thinkest means think. Thou means you. I made them in jest. Annie Dillard speaks about Quran. In Quran, Allah asks the question. The question is, the heaven and the earth and all in between thinkest thou. I made them in jest. This is the question is asked by Allah in Quran. You know what is the meaning of this question? She says in Quran, Allah asks a question. The question's meaning it is, between the heaven and earth, Allah made human beings just for a joke. Have you thought so? Just for a joke? God already created these human beings. Do you think so? She also says it is very good question. So definitely every time university asking what it is the question Allah asks in Quran. So its meaning is, between the heaven and earth, Allah made human beings just for a joke. So we knew it well. Allah made human beings not for fun. Definitely it had a serious plan. We are living with unthinkable void, with unthinkable profusion. So we are living with unthinkable void. We can see that completely empty space in this nature. We didn't find out the mysteries of nature yet. We are trying to find out, but we didn't succeed to find out the mysteries. And even we didn't identify all the minute animals and plants who are living in this nature. So we are sharing this earth with unthinkable profusion of forms. Profusion of forms means uncountable living things. We don't have an idea about the mysteries of universe. So the question is very important. She also reminds us, what do you think about nothingness, the past years and also the endless future? Actually, we human beings have no idea about nothingness, and we didn't get the clear picture of what happened in past. Even we made the history, but we can't say that it is clear. We already added all the things relating our history. Still, the history is also not completed based on the mysteries in nature. Okay, and we can't predict what will be happened in our future. what will be our future. We can't predict it. Even we can't predict this COVID-19. That is why we are facing such a situation. So we can't predict what will be happened in future, and even we don't have an idea about what already happened in past, and even we can't say about nothingness. So once again she reminds us, there are so many mysteries in this nature, but we are not at all trying to find out the mysteries clearly. Okay. If the giant water bug was not made in joke, was it then made in serious? She is asking a question very seriously. Definitely we already understood through Quran. Allah says Allah already made all the things, living and non-living things, for a special purpose. He didn't make anything just for fun. So all the living things, non-living things have their own roles in this nature. So water bugs have also their own role in this nature. Then what is the roles God already assigned for them? All the living things have their own roles. Annie Dillard starts to speak about Pascal. Have you heard about Pascal? Okay, Blaise Pascal, he is one of the greatest Christian apologists of the 17th century, who was also French mathematician, physicist, writer and inventor. Apologist means a person who argues to define or justify some religious matters. So those person we can call him as apologist. Actually Pascal, he is a Christian apologist. He speaks about the religion, Christianity. And at the same time, he was also a French mathematician, physicist, writer and inventor. So Annie Dillard speaks about Pascal's thought. Pascal used the word deus absconditus, deus absconditus. Actually the word meaning deus absconditus means hidden god. To describe the notion of the creator, Pascal used the word deus absconditus. Notion means concept. I told you he is a Christian apologist. Pascal is a Christian apologist. To speak about God, he used the word deus absconditus. Deus absconditus means hidden God. Then Annie Dillard explains that after the creation of this universe, God turning his back toward this universe. She believes so. Actually, she used the word deus absconditus by Pascal, and she explains that after creating this beautiful universe, God turning his back towards this universe. She believes that God is very cunning. God is hiding in a secret place in nature. She also says God is like a wolf who disappears the edge of the house with the Thanksgiving turkey. She strongly believes that God is here in this nature. There is no doubt it is that God created this nature. But we can't find out God. That is why she says God is very cunning. He is hiding in a very secret place. She also compares God as a wolf. A wolf who disappeared at the edge of the house with the Thanksgiving turkey. Through this, we can understand that Annie Dillard is searching for God in nature. She is sure God is in the nature. But it is very difficult to find out the secret place of God. Then Annie Dillard concludes this article with the concept of Albert Einstein. I think all of you are very familiar with Albert Einstein. So Albert Einstein said, God is subtle but not malicious. Subtle means difficult to analyze. So Einstein said, God is subtle. It is very difficult to define God, but not malicious. Malicious means evil or destructive. Even it is very difficult to find out God in this nature, but we can't say that God is malicious. Einstein also says, nature conceals her mystery as a great impressive quality. He has also the same opinion of Annie Dillard. We can see that there are so many mysteries in this nature. But you know, God conceals all the mysteries in a great impressive quality. She is not cunning. Annie Dillard says, God is not absconding himself. Absconding means concealing. Then again, she revealed that God is not concealing himself, but he spreads in subtle and grand. So actually, God is here in this world, but it is very difficult to find out, but he concealed in a very secret place, in a very impressive way. But we can feel blindly a part of it. We can feel the presence of God in this nature, but we can't find out the secret place of God. That is why Einstein also says God is subtle. It is very difficult to analyze God, but he is not malicious. He is not cunning. Even Annie Dillard also used the word cunning. He is cunning. God is cunning, just like a wolf. But in the case of Einstein, he says God is not cunning. He is subtle, but he is not malicious. Then she also uses the word hitherto shall thou come, set bars and doors. Hitherto shall thou come, set bars and doors. By using these words, Annie Dillard says, God gave a limitation to reach to God. Definitely, he fixed a limitation. He will not allow us to reach to God. There are so many limitations to human beings to reach at God. But we can move till those bars and doors. He just fixed some doors and bars. Till those doors and bars, we can move. But we human beings are not at all ready to reach at that limitation. We are not at all ready to try it. We are just wasting the time by playing Pinochle. Pinochle, it's a North American card game for two or more players using a 48 card pack. So she says human beings are not at all interested to find out where is God, where is his secret place in nature. Actually, we people are just wasting the time, just wasting our life. Then she says people are playing the game. She also gave an example, Pinochle, the game Pinochle. I told you it's a game, a North American card game for two or more players. They are playing with 48 card pack. So she says all these things in the bottom of or bottom of her heart. At the same time, Annie Dillard reminds us, if you are ready to act, we can at least reach at the limitation that God fixed. Through pilgrimage at Tinker Creek, Annie Dillard looks at the marvels of nature and searches for God. This is the end of our lesson. I just recollect all the points. Annie Dillard, while she was walking through the edges of an island, suddenly she noticed a small green frog. It was partly out in the water and in the water. That is why she felt it looked like a schematic diagram, but it didn't jump. That is why she started to observe it very keenly in the Tinker Creek, just 4 feet away. At that moment, the giant water bug attacked the green frog. At first, using its forelegs, it held the frog very tightly. After that, it injected the enzyme into frog's body. That enzyme dissolves the muscles and bones of the frogs. As the result, we can see that frog's skull broke. It looked like a kicked tent. Then she also felt it. Annie Dillard also felt it. It looked like a deflating football. She also compared this frog as a pricked balloon. Then we already identified the pathetic death of a green frog. Then she started to speak about different methods of attacking prey. First, she talked about carnivorous animals. Carnivorous animals means the animals who eat animals and plants. They are eating the animals alive by the bloody bites. At first, they are holding the victim very tightly. Then the victim can't move. Then they started to eat by the bloody bites. Then she talked about the attacking style of frogs. Frogs, they are eating the prey alive and whole. It is stuffing the prey into their mouth using their thumbs. It is very difficult for the frogs to close their mouth while they are eating a mouth full of dragonflies. Then she talked about ants. Ants, they are swarming over the newly hatched featherless birds, and using the tiny bite, they are eating those featherless birds. Then she asks the question to us, the same question Allah asked in Quran. Between the paradise and earth, God created the human beings just for joke. She also reminds us, it is a very good question. That means God created all living things very seriously. All living and non-living things have their own importance, their own roles in nature. But we human beings can't identify the mysteries in this nature. We are living with uncountable living and non-living things. We don't have any idea about those living and non-living things. We didn't identify them. There are so many mysteries in nature. That is why she also quoted the word of Pascal. Pascal, I told you, he is a Christian apologist, French mathematician, physicist, writer and inventor. He used the term deus absconditus. Deus absconditus means hidden God. Pascal was sure God is hidden in this nature. So Annie Dillard just used the word deus absconditus, the hidden God. So she says God is here in this nature, but he is concealing in a very secret place. We don't know what it is, the secret place. That is why she also compares God as cunning like a wolf. The wolf conceals in the corner of a house with a Thanksgiving turkey. Then Annie Dillard also uses Einstein's word. Einstein reveals that God is subtle but not malicious. Actually, Einstein also faced so many challenges. I already told you, we human beings are very good survivors. Not only human beings, but also the other animals, plants, all the things, all the living things. They are very good survivors. In Einstein's life, he also faced so many failures. He tried to find out the mysteries in this nature. Even when he faced the failures, he was not at all ready to blame God. He confidently declares that God is subtle but not malicious. Even he tried to identify the mysteries, even he failed a number of times, but he was very confident. He believes in God, and he was very optimistic in nature and in God. That is why he says God is subtle but not malicious. It is very difficult to find out the presence of God, but definitely God is not cruel. And she also used the word hitherto shall though come set bars and doors. So she says definitely God is here in this nature. It is very difficult to identify him because God himself made the doors and bars from him. But you know, there is a limitation. Actually, till that limitation, we human beings can go. But in the case of human beings, we are not at all ready to act. We are not at all ready to reach at least those bars and doors. That is why still we can say that there are so many mysteries in this nature. That is why she gives an encouragement for us to find out the mysteries in nature. How we can find out the mysteries? At first we started to love nature. We started to identify the nature. We started to believe in nature. Then definitely we can reach at least the limitations the God already fixed from him. So there is no doubt it is through this beautiful memoir, Pilgrim at Tinker Creek, Annie Dillard, she is giving a marvels of nature and she is searching for God. Even while we are going through this memoir, we will also feel the beauty of this nature. We can also feel to find out the mysteries of nature. So we should be ready to spend the time in nature. Actually, we people are wasting our time. Here she speaks about the game Pinocchio. In our life, we are using so many things to kill the time, I think. So we are ready to look at nature. We are ready to spend more time in nature. Then definitely, we at least we can go through the limitations God already fixed. At least we can identify some of the living and non-living things in this beautiful nature. So this is the memoir. I told you she is sharing her experience in Tinker Creek almost a year. I think all of you traveled with Annie Dillard's memoir, Pilgrim at Tinker Creek. In this journey, we already identified how a giant water bug killed a small green frog. Then we also discussed different methods of catching prey. We discussed the attacking style of carnivorous animals, frogs, and ants. She also asked a question from Quran. Allah asked a question in Quran that is also very important. Between the paradise and earth, God created man just for joy. She also added this important question to make us understand God created all human beings and animals, plants and non-living things just for fun. All the things have their own roles in this nature. But we human beings, we are not at all ready to identify the mysteries. We are living with uncountable, unknowing living things. She also quoted the word of Pascal, the great Christian apologist, Deus absconditus, hidden God. By using this word, Deus absconditus, she says, God is here in this nature. God is very cunning, like a wolf. God is concealing in a secret place. She also adds Einstein's vision relating God. Einstein says, God is subtle but not malicious. It is very difficult to identify God, but God is not so cruel. Then she also reminds us, God already fixed so many bars and doors. That is why we can't reach to the God. But it is possible to reach near the limitations. So, we human beings should be ready to identify the mysteries. At least we should try to reach at the limitations. Nowadays, we people are spoiling our life without useful things. So, I hope all of you enjoyed this beautiful memoir of Annie Dillard, Pilgrim at Tinker Creek. So, we can meet the next class. Till then, stay home, stay safe. Thank you.